to introduce you to Dr. John Hartig. He is becoming sort of a legend in our region. He's done a lot to really promote this region on a world recognized scale. And that means that he was sort of the person who did the charge for the Detroit International Wildlife Refuge. He also sits on the board for the Detroit Riverfront Conservancy. He's a visiting scholar right now at University of Windsor, the Great Lakes Institute of Environment and Research for the Great Lakes. And he's a Great Lakes Science Policy Advisor for the International Association for Great Lakes Research. So he has a good research background. And after 14 years as the refuge manager, we will see an actual wildlife visitor center come about in the next year. So John has received a number of awards for his work, including the 2017 Community Peacemaker Award from Wayne State University Center for Peace and Conflict Studies, and he has co-authored over 100 publications on the environment. John has also authored a book, Bringing Conservation to Cities. He's won a gold medal from the Nonfiction Authors Association, the Sustainable Living category, and a bronze medal from the Living Now Book Awards in the Living Green category. So let's give him a hand.
Well, good afternoon. What a great day for all of you to be on the water, huh? It's never a bad day, you know. Seems like high water levels everywhere, right? You'll see a lot of that this afternoon, I understand, you know. But I'm going to talk a little bit about this. What comes to mind when you think of Detroit?
Detroit
Renaissance Center. Some other things.
Cars.
Bablo. Professional sports, you know, music, Motown, techno, art. All those are true, but Metropolitan Detroit also has a reputation for, believe it or not, leading a number of paradigm shifts where it has impacted the nation and indeed the world. So these significant change in thinking that results in a completely changed view or outlook. So think of the printing press, the iPad, smartphones, fur trade. They literally extirpated, sort of wiped out beaver on much of the European continent. And for fashion design, for fur hats, they came over looking for beaver. And there were obviously lots of beaver right here in the heart of the Great Lakes. And Detroit went on. Literally hundreds of thousands of beaver came out of this region. Then we needed to move people and goods to settle the West. The Erie Canal got us to Buffalo. Then they had to get on some ships and come across. So Detroit became a leader of in shipbuilding. During the 1890s, more ships were built along this Detroit River than any place in America. And everyone knows the automobile paradigm shift, where Henry Ford perfected the assembly line and put literally the world on wheels. And then with a stroke of the pen, FDR converted all civilian productivity in Metropolitan Detroit to military productivity with one single purpose. That was to win World War II. And we became the arsenal of the democracy, and more tanks and Liberator bombers and ammunition and Jeeps came out of this area than anywhere in the United States. But obviously these paradigm shifts have some unintended consequences. The fur trade wiped out beaver, extirpated beaver, east of the Mississippi River. The arsenal democracy resulted in lots of pollution. There were no environmental laws. The goal was to win World War II, so anything went back in those times. So 1946 to 48, right after the war, they quantified how much oil and petroleum products were going into the Rouge, that flows in the Detroit River and the Detroit River. So that number is 5.9 million gallons of oil and petroleum products per year. It takes 1 gallon of oil to pollute 1 million gallons of water out here. That's enough oil and petroleum product to pollute the entire western basin of Lake Erie, all Ontario waters, all Ohio waters, all Michigan waters. So the winter of 1948 was really cold, and there were only a few pockets of open water out here, and what was in there? The oil. The waterfowl came down on their migrations as they had done for millennia, and landed in those open pockets that had oil in them, and 12,000 ducks and geese died in a single event. A group of duck hunters from here, from Metropolitan Detroit, picked up those oil-soaked carcasses of ducks and geese, threw them in pickup trucks, drove them to the capital, Lansing, Michigan, started throwing them on the sidewalk, threw them on the front steps of the Capitol, held a press conference on the front door of the Capitol and said, "How dare you do this to the place where we're raising our families, the place where we live, the place where we recreate." And they are now credited. We started the Industrial Pollution Control Program of Michigan. So in 1965, Time magazine, where the lead story was Lake Erie is dead. It was probably poor journalism. It was more alive than ever, just like now, more so much phosphorus going in that you have algal blooms. Algal blooms would settle out, go through decomposition, use up the oxygen. The fish and the decomposing algae would windrow on beaches like Sterling State Park, and it would take front-end loaders and dump trucks to remove all that stuff. That was 1965. People started speaking out. Here are some of the pictures. Upper right-hand corner is the confluence of the Rouge and Detroit Rivers. That conical-shaped plume you see there in the middle of the photo there is the submerged discharge pipe of the largest single-site wastewater treatment plant in North America, Detroit Wastewater Treatment Plant. And you see oil going in there. You can see here pickle liquor from some of the steel companies. This is the 60s now. And then adding insult to injury, somebody, a worker from Ford, dropped an acetylene torch, and the oil and a bunch of wood that accumulated on the Rouge River caught on fire. And this is the last remaining photo here on the bottom. It's the John Kendall, the fireboat for Detroit. Not trying to put a fire out, trying to contain a fire because it burns itself out. You can see the drawbridge there on the Rouge and the Ford Motor Company stack. One more thing, one more insult, and that was a graduate student came over from Scandinavia and was studying at the University of Western Ontario and was looking at mercury cycling up food webs, how it biomagnifies as you go up the food web. He said, this is occurring in Scandinavian lakes. What about these places like the Great Lakes that have 1/5 the standing fresh water on the Earth's surface, and they have chemical plants that are producing chlorine and caustic soda, and the byproduct is elemental mercury. What happens to that mercury? It's probably being discharged. So that was the mercury crisis. That news catapulted across the world in 1970, the mercury crisis of 1970. The two sources were primarily Petrochemical Valley in Sarnia, Ontario, and Wyandotte, Michigan, the old Wyandotte Chemical Company. So most people, when they think of the first Earth Day, they think of Santa Barbara, California, because of the Santa Barbara oil spill, or Madison, Wisconsin, for who started it. But Detroit has a huge history in the very first Earth Day, April 22nd, 1970. Here's a, on the left-hand boat, this lineman is the United Auto Workers out on the water. The boat next to it is the Canadian Auto Workers, the CAW. They're holding a wake on the Detroit River, symbolizing the death of the Detroit River on the first Earth Day, April 22nd, 1980. Think of auto workers and how many hours a week, you know, 50 and 60 hours a week are working in factories, and when they get out, do they want to sit in front of a TV? Many of them wanted to be outdoors, so they became boaters, hunters. anglers. They loved the outdoors, and they were an important part of that. So we had two more big winter waterfall die-offs in 1960 and 1967. That, along with Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, and that changed the direction of our thinking. This eutrophication, phosphorus pollution of Lake Erie, the burning of the Rouge and the Cuyahoga River. By the way, it's 50 years this October that the Rouge caught on fire, and 50 years ago this year for the Cuyahoga as well. Then the mercury crisis. That led to this major outcry of people saying, this is not right. We shouldn't be doing this. People who spoke out, that led to the first Earth Day. It led to the Canada Water Act of 1970, the Clean Water Act of 72, the Canada-US Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement, and the Endangered Species Act of 1973. An amazing set of accomplishments for people speaking out. So it's been four decades. We've seen substantial reductions in oil discharges and spills, and winter duck kills due to oil pollution have been eliminated. We've spent billions of dollars, with a B, billions of dollars of upgrading all wastewater treatment plants to secondary treatment with phosphorus removal. We've seen an over 90% decline from the great in phosphorus concentration and loading from this picture in the lower right-hand corner, the Detroit wastewater treatment plant. Since the 60s, there have been an 80% reduction in untreated combined sewer overflow volume in southeast Michigan. So, you know, old cities have combined storm and sanitary sewers. So when it rains, it exceeds the carrying capacity of the sewer system, and raw sewage can bypass the wastewater treatment plant and get dumped into, as you all know, to these receiving water bodies. So we've seen an 80% reduction in untreated volume since the 60s. Between the 60s and 80s, we saw over a 4,000 metric ton per day decrease in chloride loadings. This is because chemical plants started to look at some of these products. It's not a waste product, it's a resource. So they started recovering it, recycling it, and led to that dramatic decline. We've seen a 90% decline, a 70% decline in mercury in fish since that mercury crisis, a 90% decline in DDT, that pesticide in fish. But also, we still have health advisories on certain species and certain size classes. A 90% decline in DDE, this breakdown product of DDT, and an 85% decline in PCBs in herring gall eggs right out here on Fighting Island, down here a few miles. And then we've remediated over 1 million cubic meters of contaminated sediment at a cost of $154 million. If I stop the story there, I hope that I've convinced you that we've seen measurable improvement out here. But that's not what I want you to remember. Bald eagles tried to reproduce for 25 years and couldn't because of eggshell thinning, because of organochlorine pesticides like DDT, dieldrin, toxaphene, things like that. And they're back in a big way, 25 active nests after a 25-year absence. And you see them flying over Belle Isle, along the Riverwalk, everywhere. You know, it's really neat. Peregrine falcons, the same story. They tried to reproduce, couldn't because of these organochlorine pesticides. And now we fledge 30 young per year in this area. Osprey are back. First on the lower end of Detroit River, the first time since the 1890s that osprey had nested in Wayne County. We did everything humanly possible to lake sturgeon. We got some lake sturgeon people out here. We built the shipping channels and took out massive amounts of spawning habitat for them. We've filled wetlands. We've developed over wetlands. We have a 97% loss of coastal wetlands. That's their nursery habitat. For a while, we treated them as a trash fish, and so they would just kill them and throw them overboard. And adding insult to injury, during the steamer days, they would harvest these 6 and 7 foot lake sturgeon, put them on docks, dry them out, stack them like cordwood as high as they could go, and then dry them out and burn them in steamers as a fuel source. in the Great Lakes. Amazing. So they're back now, and we've built nine different sturgeon spawning reefs between Canada and the United States. Whitefish are back for the first time since 1916. Back in the 70s, the walleye population was in a crisis state, according to the Lake Erie Committee of the Great Lakes Fishery Commission. Of course, we're part of the walleye capital of the world now, and we have tournaments out here for $500,000 each spring. And beaver are back in six locations, including here on Belle Isle. So if you add that up, the return of peregrine falcons, bald eagles, osprey, lake sturgeon, lake whitefish, beaver, mayflies, it's one of the most remarkable ecological recovery stories in North America. That's because of where we started, how bad it was, but it's a great thing. Most people don't know that. We still have lots of challenges like this, the amount of people we have, transportation expansion, think of urban sprawl. Despite our best efforts, we still have incremental loss and degradation of habitat in our areas. We still have the runoff off our roads, our rooftops, our parking lots, urban non-point source pollution. We still have the legacy of the Industrial Revolution in contaminated sediments and contaminated brownfields. We've been ground zero for exotic species like zebra and quagga mussels. And of course, we have greenhouse gas emissions and climate change. So out of this recovery came an opportunity to think differently. It's not just a polluted river in the Rust Belt, but it could become an international wildlife refuge. And so with John Dingell's help, it stretches from southwest Detroit to the Ohio border, and on the Canadian side goes from Peche Isle and Lake St. Clair all the way down Detroit River and goes far east as Point Pelee National Park and Pelee Island. There's about 6,200 acres on our U.S. Registry of Lands for it from the Fish and Wildlife Service. There's about 7,900 acres from the Michigan Department of Natural Resources. Places like Erie State Game Area, Point Mouillé State Game Area. On the Canadian Registry of Lands, Essex Region Conservation Authority has about 3,800 acres, and the City of Windsor has about 1,000 acres. Places like Ojibwe Prairie, the last remaining tall grass prairie in southwest Ontario. So in total, there's over 18,700 acres devoted to conservation and outdoor recreation. The goal is 25,000 in the next 10 years. That's not a big number, 18,700, when you think of Alaska. But if you think there's nearly 7 million people in a 45-minute drive, that's a big number, especially with how old we are. Out of that recovery as well, there was an opportunity to rethink the whole waterfront in Detroit. In its first 10 years, in the worst economy, Detroit was the largest city in the United States to go through bankruptcy. In that time, when they went through bankruptcy, they raised $110 million to build the first portions of the Riverwalk. In addition, they have $40 million in an endowment to operate, care, maintain, and program the Detroit Riverwalk in perpetuity with quality. The return on that investment, you invest that amount of money, has been over $1 billion of investment, is the return on that initial investment. An amazing story. If you've not been there, I encourage you to stop there. We've also been thinking broadly all the way from Southern Lake Huron, the St. Clair River, Lake St. Clair. There's places in the United States that have brought all the stakeholders, the outdoor recreational, the conservation stakeholders together and formed some kind of an organization. In Chicago, it's called Chicago Wilderness. There's different names for them throughout the country. We had not done that up until recently, and ours is going to be called Semi-Wild, so play on Southeast Michigan, wild. If you look at this map, there's about 197,000 acres of parkland and conservation land already in existence in this area. Pretty amazing. So the vision of Semwai Wild is that all people in the metropolitan Detroit region have access to and actively steward nature and promote ecosystem sustainability. I'm going to work, think there are pots of money only open nationally to where you think on a regional scale like this. So this now opens up that we can apply for some. For example, Detroit Audubon got a grant to do some environmental education for kids around birding. So we want to implement this vision through a bunch of strategic actions, be a forum to coordinate plans and share interests, add value to existing organization, advanced education and advocacy for nature and conservation, share knowledge and best practices, and really collaborate on a big scale. Again, is going after some of this money that is available out there that we could not go for before because we didn't have this kind of an organization. It is brand new. Where do most people on the globe, what percentage of people on the earth now live in urban areas? 54%. What percentage of people in the United States and Canada live in urban areas? It's the same percentage. 80% of all Canadians and U.S. citizens now live in urban areas. Where's the next generation of conservationists, sustainability entrepreneurs going to come from? It's obviously going to come from urban areas. It's my favorite quote. There are millions of difficult challenges and delightful opportunities ahead. I think the only constraint is the willingness to dream, to create, and to hope and feel undefended enough to face the tough questions and ideas that must be fiercely engaged at this moment in human history. If design is the signal of human intention, let me repeat that. If design is the signal of human intention, then we must ask ourselves, what are our intentions for our children, for the children of all species, and for all time? And how do we profitably and boldly manifest the best of those intentions? We look forward to the future. We think that we have something that's truly unique throughout the world, starting at Southern Lake Huron, St. Clair River, Lake St. Clair, Detroit River, Western Lake Erie, and there's a lot that we can do together and to help our economies, improve quality of life for our communities, and give a gift to the future generations of a cleaner environment. So thank you very much.